पृथिवी शान्तिरन्तरिक्षगं शान्तिर्द्यौः शान्तिर्दिशान्तिरवान्तर दिशा शान्तिरग्निःशान्तिर्वायुः शान्तिरादित्यशान्तिश्चन्द्रमा शान्तिर्नक्षत्राणि शान्तिराप शान्तिरोषधयः शान्तिर्वनस्पतयः शान्तिर्गौः शान्तिरजा शान्तिरश्वः शान्तिः पुरुषः शान्तिर्ब्रह्म शान्तिर्ब्राह्मणः शान्तिः शान्तिरेव शान्तिः शान्तिर्मे अस्तु शान्तिः. May there be peace on earth and in the sky. May there be peace in the water and in all directions. May there be peace in the plants, in the trees, and in animals. May there be peace in the hearts of all beings. May there be peace in everyone and in everything. Sarvetra sukhina santo, sarve santu niramayaha. Sarve bhadrani pashyanto, ma kaschit dukha bhag bhavet. Sarvastaratu durgani, sarvo bhadrani pashyato. Sarvasadbuddhimapnoto, sarvasarvatra nandato. May all be happy and healthy. May all see what is good. And may no one experience misery. May all overcome their obstacles and acquire good tendencies. May people everywhere find joy and fulfillment. Let us now spend some time touching the center of peace and joy in our hearts. A good way to begin the practice is to withdraw the scattered energies of the mind and bring them to rest on one point. That point can be our own breathing. Let us therefore practice breathing with awareness. As we breathe in, let us visualize that our body and mind are being filled with love, strength, and compassion. And as we breathe out, let us release all the stress, anxiety, and exhaustion in the body and mind. Let us practice this way for a while. Let us now turn our attention to the region of our heart. Although God is present everywhere and in everyone, the divine presence can be felt most clearly in our own hearts. We can meditate in any way we have been taught. To remain focused, we can take the help of a short mental prayer or a mantra or a divine name. Let us now spend some time dwelling on the presence of God in our hearts. Om Asatoma Satkamaya Tamasoma Jyotirgamaya Mrityorma Amritam Gamaya Aviravir Mahedhi Rudrayate Dakshinam Mukham Tenamam Pahi Nityam. May the Divine lead us from the unreal to the real, from darkness to light, from death to immortality. May the Divine Consciousness fill our hearts and protect us. Begin today with the study of Kaivalya Upanishad. This forms one among a set of Upanishads which are collectively sometimes called the minor Upanishads. Minor because not because they are less important, but because they are very small in size. Also, it's possible that in the Vedic history, these are a little bit later than some of the earlier Upanishads. The number of Upanishads is sometimes said to be 28, sometimes 108, and sometimes the number can be more, because these Upanishads were is a form of literature that's been added over time. There have also been a relatively more recent Upanishads, which are, you can't strictly call them a part of the Vedas, but over time there have been Upanishads, for instance, called Narayan Upanishad, Surya Upanishad. In fact, I don't know how old it is. It's a few hundred years old. There is also one Allo Upanishad. The idea was that over time, people who worshipped God in different forms and in different ways wanted to connect their tradition with the Vedic tradition to show that the basic philosophy behind all these different sampradayas or different denominations, to trace the lineage back to the Vedas, it was felt it would be good to have an Upanishad based on the followers of Surya or Narayana, even someone who wanted to probably emphasize the importance of religious harmony, to show that the truth is one, that it can be reached in many different ways. Someone, they also wrote an Allah Upanishad, the one who is worshipped as Allah, is not different, essentially. While the conceptually, theologically, they might appear to be different, but as far as the truth is concerned, whether someone is a Christian, a Muslim, or a Buddhist, they are all really going toward the same truth. So Kaivalya Upanishad is a part of the Atharva Veda. We know that the Vedic literature is divided into four books, and Atharva Veda is one of that. So this Upanishad occurs in the Atharva Veda. Kaivalya is a term that comes from the word Kevala. Kevala means one. It also stands for the highest. Because we know in Vedanta, we see that the reality is ultimately one, or more technically, not two. Advaita. A means no, Dvaita is two. So not two, non-dual. So Kevala means the only one. So it refers to that highest reality. Now, many of these bigger and older Upanishads deal with the topic in a more nuanced way. There's obviously a lot more space in it for them to discuss. But many of these minor Upanishads, they often deal with some specific theme, or they summarize the essential teachings of these bigger Upanishads. Now, Kaivalya Upanishad has some important points, but all of these are more in terms of summary of the things that we have already seen in Upanishads, the things that we have already studied in these in our study group meetings. So it will be possible for us to study this a little at a faster pace than we have been doing some of the other texts. And when there are things, you will find a lot of these things we have discussed before. If there are things that need some further description, I will dwell on it and we'll have a better idea. And then, of course, if you have any specific questions or comments, we'll have time for that as well. So I'll read the first one. I think I will just do the reading, no need to repeat. Atha Āśvalāyano bhagavantam parameshthinam upasametya uvacha. Adhihi bhagavan brahma vidyam varishtham sada satphihi sevyamanam nigudham. Yaya achirat sarva papam vyapoya parat param purusham yati vidvan. Then Āśvalāyana approached Blessed Brahma and said, "Teach me, revered master, the highest knowledge of Brahman, which is hidden and always sought by the seekers of truth, and by which the wise drive away all sense and reach the highest being." Many of these Upanishads begin with a student approaching the teacher and are usually in the form of a conversation. And so here, the student is Āśvalāyana, who approaches Blessed Brahma. Brahma has to be distinguished from Brahman. The root from which both these terms come is the same, but Brahma is a masculine gender, and it refers to the Trinity, Brahma, Vishnu, Maheshwara. Brahma as the one who does the Srishti, from whom the universe comes. Vishnu is that aspect of the divine that preserves the universe, and Shiva is that aspect of the divine unto whom the whole universe is absorbed back again. And we know that this is not a one-time event, that this keeps on happening again and again and again. So the entire process of creation, preservation, and then absorption. Sometimes people call it destruction, which really gives a very different idea. So it's more, it comes from that one, it dwells in that one, and it is absorbed back into that one. So these three functions are personified in the form of Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva. So that is Brahma, who is really referred to here. Now, oftentimes in
Vedanta, we also speak of Brahman. So Brahman is really actually a neuter gender. And therefore the Brahman is neither masculine nor feminine. So Brahman, when we say it, everything is filled with Brahman, that I am Brahman, that means we're really going beyond gender. Because Brahman is no body, no mind, no gender, no defining characteristic. So even when we sometimes try to refer to Brahman as Sat-Chit Ananda not really a description of Brahman. Because Brahman cannot be described. It's beyond words. So when we say Brahman is Sat, even to say Brahman is real is philosophically untenable. Because you cannot say, if you cannot say Brahman is inexpressible, you cannot even say Brahman is real. So when we say Brahman is real, what we really mean is Brahman is not unreal. So you can only say what Brahman is not. So when we say Brahman is Sat, what we really mean is Brahman is not Asat. Brahman is Chit, means Brahman is not Achit. Brahman is not material, Brahman is pure consciousness. Same thing with Ananda. It's not that Brahman is bliss, but Brahman is not the opposite of bliss. So that is important to remember. So here, the student Āśvalāyana goes to the teacher, Brahma, and says, teach me, revered master, the highest knowledge of Brahman. Which is hidden, clearly. If it were obvious, everyone would be enlightened. So it is hidden. In the early days, it was hidden in the sense of it was not even available. Now, it's not hidden in the terms of words, because the knowledge of Brahman, at least textually, can be read about in books or can be seen on the internet. So it's not hidden in that sense. But simply having the words doesn't mean we know it. Even having the ability to read, even having the ability to understand the language, still doesn't mean we know it. Because we can read it, we can understand it intellectually. So understanding intellectually is one kind of knowledge, that is indirect knowledge. But here, what he is seeking is not simply indirect knowledge, but direct experience. So that we have to keep in mind as well. And until and unless that direct experience comes, that knowledge of Brahman is still hidden and always sought by the seekers of truth, by which the wise drive away all sins and reach the highest being. Now the word papa, sarva papam vyapohya, the word papa sometimes gets translated as sin. It's okay to translate it that way. But it's good to keep in mind that sin has a very specific meaning in Judeo-Christian thought. Sin is a theological category. If you want to look at it in a technical sense, then sin means an act of disobedience to God. God has given mankind this 10 commandments, and whoever breaks these commandments, whoever disobeys God, is committing a sin. So that kind of sin does not exist in Vedanta. Because in Vedanta, there is no commandment that God has given. There is nothing that needs to be obeyed or disobeyed. So if you want to understand sin as a specific theological concept, then the word sin is probably not the right one. Swami Vivekananda said, Vedanta recognizes no sin. Vedanta recognizes error. We can make mistake. And if we can make mistake, we have to, of course, face the consequences of that mistake. But once we learn what our mistake is, we can then get rid of it as well. So that is the distinction to be kept in mind, even when we read the word papa being translated as sin and reach the highest being. Verse 2. Tasmai saha ovacha pitamahascha shraddha bhakti dhyana yogat avaihi na karmana na prajaya dhanena tyage naike amrutatvam anashuhu. To him Brahma said, learn this through faith, devotion and meditation.
not by work, nor by progeny, nor by wealth, but by renunciation alone, some attained to immortality. So now, in response, the Brahma said that three things are necessary in order to get that highest knowledge. Shraddha, faith, bhakti, devotion, and meditation. We all already had a long discussion on bhakti when we studied Narada Bhakti Sutra. We have also seen that the word bhakti can be understood in many different ways. Bhakti need not be restricted only to a personal God. Bhakti need not be seen only as a dualistic practice. Shankaracharya, in that book Viveka Chudamani, describes bhakti as Svasvarupa Anusandhanam Bhakti Iti Abhidiyate. Even a one-pointed examination, one-pointed exploration of one's own true nature can also be called bhakti. So bhakti is a practice of giving our whole being towards a spiritual ideal. That ideal can be anthropomorphic, non-anthropomorphic, that ideal can be outside, the ideal can be inside. But bhakti is primarily directed toward God, depending on whatever our concept of God is. And that is why Brahma says that we need to get that highest knowledge through faith, devotion, and meditation. Shraddha, bhakti, dhyana yoga. And then he says, not by work, nor by progeny. So this term, na karmana, na prajaya, dhanena, comes in older Upanishads as well. So, attaining immortality. Which are the different ways we can strive to attain immortality? There is the story told about the filmmaker Woody Allen, who has made many movies, and there are some people who like his movies. And someone told him that you have made such amazing movies, you have become immortal through your movies. And then he said, I don't want to become immortal through my movies. I want to become immortal by not dying. And so that's what we sometimes say when people pass away. Oh, this person has done so much good. The world will never forget this person. So, since death seems inevitable, what are the ways that we can somehow continue to live in this world after dying? And that is why sometimes you will see when people give donations, they often want something to be inscribed there, in memory of so and so, or this person has given a donation. The idea is, even if I die, my name will somehow remain. If you go to some of the places of pilgrimage in India, Banaras especially, you will see, if you go to on the bank of the Ganga or any of the temples, so many marble slabs. People have donated, but they haven't made an anonymous donation. They want their name to be there. And the idea is, well, even if I physically go away, my name will somehow remain there. So there is a kind of quasi-immortality, at least as long as that name remains. Another way immortality can be reached is often through our children and grandchildren. So, oftentimes parents see a reflection of themselves in their children. They feel that somehow, even when they physically pass away, they are somehow still there in this world. Through their children, they continue to exist in some way. Another way people try to remember to become immortal is through doing good work. So you do some great activity and you are recognized by the community.
and some memorial comes in your name, or you build a building and the building is named after you. So that is why here Brahma says that renunciation, that immortality can be reached only through renunciation, tyaga. It not by work. If you do some good work, of course people will recognize you and building will be built. No building is eternal, we know that. A next earthquake, a terrible earthquake can go, or a roadway is going to be built, or people want a larger building. So eventually that building will go away. All of these things, these kind of ways of attaining immortality, are not a truly real ways of attaining immortality. That's kind of a consolation to oneself that I'll somehow still continue to be. But the real immortality can be reached only by renunciation. And by renunciation is meant our present clinging to the body and mind as me, that is the main problem. So if I'm able to renounce my attachment to this form of body and mind as me, then I can be truly immortal, because then I will know I am the Atman. What prevents me from knowing my divine nature at present is my firm conviction that I am a human being, and my resistance to the idea that at some point what makes me a human being, this human body, will one day crumble and go away. And I resist that idea, at least mentally, even if I cannot resist it, even if I cannot stop it. There are some people who do believe that medical science at some point will reach a point when people will not have to die. Good luck. Verse number 3.
Parena nakam nihitam guhayam viprajate yat yatayo vishanti Vedanta vijnana sunishchitarthaha sanyasa yogat yataya shuddha sattvaha te brahmalokeshu parantakale paramrutat parimuchyanti sarve. The shining one who is attained by the self-controlled is higher than heaven and is seated in the cave of the heart. The self-controlled are of pure minds and have clear view of the reality through their knowledge of Vedanta and the practice of renunciation. In Brahmaloka, at the time of cosmic dissolution, all of them get fully liberated and go beyond the so-called immortality.
There's several things here. Some of these things are clear. The shining one, the Atman, which is effulgent, self-effulgent. Everything else gets their effulgence from the Atman. It's like the best example that we can see in our present state is the sun. The sun, the moon, in order for us to see the moon, we need the sun. It's the sun's light that is reflected from the moon. The moon doesn't have any light of its own. But in order to see the sun, we don't need another sun. And therefore, sun is, in this example, is self-effulgent, while the moon and everything else is not self-effulgent. We get to see, when we say it's daytime, it's because the sun illumines everything. In the same way, the shining one, the Atman, is the only one which is a seat of consciousness, which is the source of consciousness. We become aware of everything in the world because of the Atman. If the Atman were not there, then we wouldn't be aware of anything. But to be aware of the Atman, we don't need another awareness. Just like we don't need another source of light to look at the sun, we don't need any other awareness to become aware of the Atman. Therefore, Atman is self-effulgent, self-aware. Is higher than heaven. No matter how high the heaven is still a temporary place. In the Gita, Krishna says, "A Brahma Bhuvana Lokaha Punaravartinojana." The highest heaven described in our books is called the Brahma Loka. Even Brahma Loka, A Brahma Bhuvana Lokaha, all these, even Brahma Loka, people have to still be reborn again. Maybe if you go to the highest heaven, you live for a longer time. Maybe the smaller heavens, maybe shorter time. just a difference in time, but you still have to come back. And therefore, attaining the enlightenment, you never have to come back. So even the highest heaven is not high enough. Highest heaven is still in the realm of samsara. That is what Shankaracharya points out in his commentary. And so this is higher than heaven, seated in the cave of the heart. Cave, difficult to reach. You have been keep listening to what just happened in Thailand, how it was difficult to reach those that youngsters, the young football team, and how difficult it was to extract them from that cave. If such is the case with a physical cave, think about the cave of the heart. First of all, we have to locate where that cave is, then go inside and find the Atman. And so recognize that it is something that needs a lot of daring. Even the rescue operation in Thailand needed a lot of daring, a lot of sacrifice. Without that sacrifice, without that daring, without that courage, without that patience, it wouldn't have happened. We need all of those qualities to dive deep inside the cave of our own heart. The self-controller of pure minds and have clear view of the reality through their knowledge of Vedanta. And how do we know what to do about it? That is where Vedanta helps. Vedanta here understood in the sense of the insights found in the Upanishads and those which have been then taught and shared through a great lineage of teachers down the centuries, not only through their books but through their teaching, even saints. So all of these great ones, their teachings can ultimately be traced back to Vedanta. Since Vedanta is the spiritual foundation on which this whole edifice of spiritual life stands. So what knowledge we get from the Vedanta, when we make that knowledge our own, when that knowledge becomes not just cerebral, not just intellectual, but a part of our own experience, then we become liberated. And the practice of it, so knowledge of Vedanta and practice of renunciation, it is then that we have the clear view of reality. Then he says, in Brahmaloka, at the time of cosmic dissolution, all of them get fully liberated and go beyond the so-called immortality. So these two terms need a little bit of explanation. What does it mean to get fully liberated? What is this partial liberation? And what does this mean, a so-called immortality? So, first of all, there are two kinds of, this is going to sound odd, but bear with me. There are two kinds of mukti, two kinds of freedom. One freedom is called jivan mukti. Jivan mukti means being liberated while living. Now, I said that freedom or enlightenment means recognizing I am the Atman by eliminating, by renouncing my clinging to the body, mind, ego, and just experiencing that I am the Atman. Just as I now experience I am a human being, I'm not intellectually thinking I'm a human being, I'm actually experiencing I'm a human being. But right now I'm intellectually thinking I am the Atman. But when I experience I am the Atman, then I become liberated. But I don't die. I am still living. That's why jivan mukti, liberated while still living. So that's one kind of freedom. So when we become enlightened, we don't drop dead. That's good news. So don't delay your enlightenment thinking, everything will finish. Nothing will finish. You will still there. And so that's jivan mukti. But we know, enlightened beings also, their body is still mortal. Their body is still subject to the laws of matter because the body is material. And since it's material, it has to follow the laws of matter. So even enlightened beings' body will one day die, will one day get throat cancer. Even avatars get throat cancer. We saw that Ramakrishna had cancer. Whether Ramakrishna had cancer would probably not an accurate statement. His body had cancer. So sometimes when we say, I'm having this, we're actually not being that's not really accurate. So even if we have certain illness, when you're speaking with your family or friend, don't say my body has this, it's going to sound odd. Just say you have it. But deep in your heart, you know, even when you say I have a headache or I am not well, in your mind you should translate it, my body is not well. Or when you say I am unhappy or I am miserable, in your mind it should be translated as my mind is miserable, not me, because I am the Atman. So that's the way the practice goes. So even an enlightened being, Jivan Mukta, the Jivan Mukta body will one day die. When that body dies, then that is called Videha Mukti. So a Jivan Mukta is in the body, liberated, but still the Jivan Mukta still has to sleep, still has to eat, still has to do everything that other human beings do. But internally, the person is free. But when that body also disappears, then they are fully liberated. That is, even this semblance of the body no longer limits them in any way. So these are two kinds of mukti. Jivan Mukti, Videha Mukti. Now there is a third kind of mukti also. And that is really what is referred here. In Brahmaloka, at the time of cosmic dissolution, all of them get fully liberated. This third kind of mukti is called Krama Mukti. Krama Mukti means gradual liberation. So think about it this way. If there is a spiritual seeker who is striving really hard to attain enlightenment and comes quite close to enlightenment, hasn't reached the goal yet, but comes pretty close to it. But such a seeker also is living inside a body, and the body is one day going to die. Now what happens in the case of a spiritual seeker who is sincerely pursuing his or her spiritual path and the body dies before this person has attained enlightenment? Now if I have reached a pretty close to that situation, then obviously, first of all, I'm a good person, because otherwise how would I even go closer to the goal? Now since I'm a good person and I have thought good thoughts, I have done good things in life, and I have not yet attained the highest, I have to be going to be reborn somewhere. And usually, if I'm a good person, I'm going to be born in some good place. And if I'm really, you know, really good person, have come pretty close to attaining immortality, I'll probably be born in that highest of heaven, Brahmaloka. Now, heaven, as we understand it, is a place where we lack nothing. And that's why it's a place of enjoyment. There are things that will make us happy and fulfilled for a limited time. But still, that's a great place to be in. Now, if I'm just a kind of a regular good person, these terms are terrible. So I'm just kind of a good person. Now, if I'm a good person and I go to heaven and I find, oh, there is a lot of somarasa to be drunk, there's a lot of dancing and singing and music and things to make me happy, delicious food. And naturally, if I'm saying, well, I've been a good person and through God's grace, all these things have come, God wants me to enjoy it, let me enjoy it. And there is no harm because, well, you have gone to heaven, things are available to you, make use of them. But let's see a very serious spiritual seeker who has not attained enlightenment, but now death has come, and now this person finds himself or herself in Brahmaloka with all this delicious food and all these wonderful things. Now, what will such a spiritual seeker do there? Will the spiritual seeker say, okay, now let me keep my spiritual practice on hold for a while and just have fun a little bit of that? That's one. Or if this person has been serious enough to be able to let go or keep away from all these distractions while in this world, why will this person want to be distracted in that other world? So this spiritual seeker will go to Brahmaloka. All these distractions are available. All this person will say, is there some quiet tree I can just go and just continue my japa and meditation? And it's possible, of course. No one stops you. There is nobody's forcing you to enjoy there. Things are available. Whether to use it or not, use it just like when you go somewhere and stay in a hotel, there is a complimentary breakfast. Well, it's available. If you want, you can go and eat it. They are not going to force you to eat it. If you say, no, I don't like it or I don't want it, I'll go somewhere out and eat it. You have freedom. So similarly, when you go to Brahmaloka, there's all these things available. But if you say, no, my spiritual practice is more important to me than all of this. So if now I continue to practice renunciation, even after going to Brahmaloka, find myself some quiet spot, as he will mention in the next verse, and continue my meditation practice. Now remember, I had come pretty close to enlightenment. A little bit of it was remaining. So I continue my practice in Brahmaloka, finish that little bit of portion, and then become. That's what is meant by saying in Brahmaloka, at the time of cosmic dissolution, all of them get fully liberated and go beyond the so-called immortality. So it's possible for me to finish a little bit of remaining thing and then I become liberated from there. I don't have to be reborn back on this earth. That's why it's called krama mukti, gradual liberation. So then Brahmaloka becomes kind of a... Sometimes when you go on a long flights, or somewhere you are to, there is a layover. There is no non-stop flight. So you could say Brahmaloka is that you have a layover there. And finish the thing, catch the next flight from Brahmaloka to enlightenment. So three kinds of liberations. Jivan Mukti, Videha Mukti. They are obviously connected. A Jivan Mukta will eventually, when the body goes away, will become a Videha Mukta. Those earnest seekers who have practiced renouncing all distractions in this plane, when they die, even before enlightenment, when they die, then whichever higher loka they go to, when they go to Brahmaloka, they will refuse to get distracted by the enjoyments of that heaven, will finish whatever remaining portion of their spiritual practice was and become enlightened from there. That's called gradual liberation or krama mukti. So try to keep these three in mind. Don't try for krama mukti. Strive for jivan mukti. That's what the ideal we want. We want to be free now, right now. But no, there is a backup option. If you don't succeed, there is a backup. But remember, you have to go pretty close to enlightenment to make use of that backup. So aim for that highest right now. That's the idea. Next verses. Vivikta deshe cha sukha sanastha shuchi samagriva shira shariraha atyashramastha sakalendriyani nirutya bhaktya swagurum pranamya ritpundarikam virajam vishuddham vichintya madhye vishadam vishokam. In a secluded place, sitting in an easy posture, observing inner and outer purity, with neck, head and body straight, firm in the spirit of renunciation, having controlled all the senses, saluting one's own guru with devotion, meditating in the lotus of the heart on the untainted pure being who is free from sorrow. Next verse. Achintyam avyaktam anantarupam shivam prashantam amritam brahmayonim tatha adi madhyant vihinam ekam vibhum chidanandam arupam adbhutam. Who is invisible, has infinite forms and is beyond the reach of the mind, who is good, peaceful, immortal, and the origin of the universe, who is without beginning, middle, and end, who is one, all-pervading, consciousness, bliss, the formless, the wonderful. Next verse, 7. Uma sahayam parameshwaram prabhum trilochanam neelakantham prashantam
Dhyatva munihi gacchati bhutayonim samasta sakshim tamasav parastat. The great god allied with Uma, is a reference to Shiva, powerful, three-eyed, blue-necked and tranquil, the contemplative reaches the source of all, the witness of all, who is beyond darkness.
A pretty long description. All of these things are something that we have already discussed before, and it's pretty clear what is being said here. How we should meditate, what is the kind of steps we need to take, and the different adjectives that are applied to that highest reality. And the reference to Shiva, allied with Uma, the Shakti, shows us that our spiritual practice can take many forms. It doesn't necessarily have to be only directly on that undivided, formless Brahman. Even those who worship or meditate on divine in some form, and that is where the reference to Shiva and the Shakti come here. Even through them, they become the windows, they become the doorway through which we enter this infinite realm of non-duality. So, meditating in the way our Guru has taught us, following all these steps, we will reach that infinite one. And so even when we go to Brahmaloka, we can still, nobody stops us from continuing to do our spiritual practice. The connection that we have with our Gurus is not only for this life. Guru remains with us. That is what the texts say. The Guru remains with us until our enlightenment. So we can continue our spiritual practice whichever loka we will be if we die without attaining God in this life. Verse 8. Sa Brahma, Sa Shiva, Sa Indraha, Soksharaha, Paramaswarat, Sa Eva Vishnuhu, Sa Pranaha, Sa Kalognihi, Sa Chandramaha. He is Brahma, He is Shiva, He is Indra, He is the immutable, the supreme, the self-luminous, He alone is Vishnu, He is Prana, He is time, He is fire, He is the moon. Because God alone exists, Brahman alone exists. Since Brahman alone exists, whatever else that we see in this world, material or non-material, is nothing but a manifestation of that one reality, of that one being. Verse 9. Sa eva sarvam yad bhutam yaccha bhavyam sanatanam jnatvatam mrityumatyeti nanyav pantha vimuktaye. He alone is all that was and all that will be, the eternal. Knowing him, a person transcends death. There is no other way to freedom. So, because we will be born again and again, if we don't, until we realize God, we'll also die again and again. So, we will not be able to transcend death since we have to die every time we are born. The only way to stop dying is to stop being born. And the only way to stop being born is to get that highest knowledge. Because birth, by definition, means acquiring a body. And the body is acquired in order to do and experience the results of karma. And karma is operative as long as I have ignorance. So all these are related terms. Ignorance, desire, I mentioned the karma chain to you several times before. Avidya, kama, karma, janma, dukkham. Ignorance of my true nature, produces desire in the heart. Desire leads to karma. Karma leads to the karma phala. Karma phala means acquiring a body, because only through a body I can experience either joy and sorrow. And then we have seen that even though we might think of our experience as joy and sorrow, from a highest spiritual standpoint, it is really just sorrow. Unless and until I have realized God, it is just dukkham. That is why Buddha says everything is suffering. That is why Krishna refers to the world as joyless, asukham in the Gita. And so the chain begins with ignorance, ends with sorrow and suffering. The only way to break that chain is through this practice of the four yogas, using different instruments to break that chain. In the path of Karma Yoga, we use the instrument of detachment. In the path of Jnana Yoga, we use the instrument of Viveka or discernment. In the path of Bhakti Yoga, we use the instrument of longing, that love for God. In the path of Raja Yoga, we use the instrument of this inner discipline, purity and disciplining of the mind. So there are these different instruments that we can use to break the chain. Unless and until that chain is broken, we cannot be free. That's the idea. So we'll stop here today on verse number 9. You have any thoughts or questions or ideas about anything that we have discussed today? Anything that we have read today? Yeah.
Namaskar, Swamiji. This idea of Videha Mukti, you were talking about at the dissolution of the body. Does one have to go through Jivan Mukti first to become Videha Mukti?
Yes.
Okay. And then I've also heard this term...
Well, I mean, one rare possibility is you are enlightened just the moment before dying. Then you have been a Jivan Mukta for one moment, and then you have got Videha Mukti. That's okay. Possible, yeah.
And then you spoke about Krama Mukti, which is the gradual liberation. Is there something called instantaneous liberation as well?
No, Jivan Mukti is instantaneous liberation.
Okay. I've heard the term Shravya Mukti. Is that the same? Shravya? Shravya, S-R-A-V-Y-A? I don't know if that means...
No, never heard of that.
Okay.
No, never heard.
Thanks.
Swamiji, you said in Vedanta and that there is no as such as sin. It's error. We make a mistake. So my understanding is error is done by mistake or done by unconsciously. We don't do consciously error. But sin means that we are doing something consciously. We know that it's wrong and I'm doing it. So my question is that I know if I follow my guru's instruction, I will get Jivan Mukti. And somehow, consciously I know it is the right thing to do, and I can't follow. So am I making a mistake or it's a sin?
Again, as I said, there is no problem in using the word sin. I just wanted to make it clear that the word sin as it is used in Judeo-Christian thought and the word sin that is used here is not exactly identical. So the error means I make a mistake, and it's not necessarily always unconscious. There are sometimes things we know are wrong, but we cannot stop ourselves from doing it. So that's the problem. And that's a mistake, because it's a mistake because I suffer for it afterwards. I regret it. I feel bad about it. And so we can see that error is not always done because I didn't know it was wrong. In fact, many of the mistakes that we make in life is not because we don't know what is right, but we cannot stop ourselves from doing what is wrong. And so either way. And then in the legal system that we have, there is a person gets killed. Now, if a person gets killed intentionally, then that, if someone kills another person intentionally, then that's a murder. But if someone gets killed because of an action of another person, but not there was no intention of killing that person, then they say, well, I think they call it involuntary manslaughter or something like that. And therefore, if it's an involuntary manslaughter, there was no intention in killing someone, the person still will have to undergo some punishment. But that punishment is less than if it was an intentionally pre-planned murder. So similarly, in karma also, if I make a mistake without knowing that I'm making a mistake, I still have to suffer. But that suffering is generally less than if I make a mistake when being fully knowing that this was something I shouldn't do. So suffering in either case, but one will be less, one will be more.
Swamiji, I'm curious regarding the second verse that you read out, that Brahma said that faith, meditation, and devotion, these are the three things needed. So I'm curious as to, you know, where does inquiry fit into this scheme?
Well, meditation is inquiry is a form of meditation, nididhyasana in Vedanta.
Okay, so that's included in this?
Oh yeah, I mean these are very broad terms. Okay. Dhyana yoga is not... Meditation itself is a very broad term. It includes practices that can be found in all the four yogas.
Because I was kind of reminded about in Panchadashi, in Swami Vidyaranya, he distinguishes between meditation and reflection.
Right. Yeah, but these are very comprehensive terms here. He's not referring to any specific meditation practice. Thank you.
Swamiji, when we go through all the verses, when I go to the 7, 8, and 9, mm-hmm. You started distinguishing. So we say we are one as a whole with the Advaita, that part of the one, and we are the one. And then we are trying to sort of meditate upon somebody here. They're saying the God and then Shiva, Uma, and so forth. Mm-hmm. So what is the distinction then between... is there a distinction there between the greater God and the Atman then?
No, there is no distinction. Even a worshipper of Shiva, let's say, or Vishnu, a devotee of Shiva or Vishnu will, when that highest parabhakti, highest devotion or love for Shiva or Vishnu fills the devotee's heart. For that devotee, Shiva is all that exists. Vishnu is all that exists. And so, at that point, even the devotee's ego goes out. And so there is just one reality. That reality, that devotee sees that reality as Shiva. But reality is the same. This devotee may call it Shiva. And somebody else might call it Brahman. Somebody else might call the same reality as Narayana, but the reality is the same. You can see, Sri Ramakrishna says many times in the Gospel that which others call Brahma, I call Kali. Now Kali, one might say, well, how can Kali and Brahman be the same? But when he was using the term, when he, Ramakrishna, worshipped and had that experience of Kali, it was not like, oh, here is this now mother and I'm a child. Then that is still, as long as my awareness of myself is distinct from Kali, then she's the mother and I'm a child. But if I'm all just experiencing just the mother, I'm just experiencing that one, but I just choose to call that one mother. And somebody might choose to call that one by any other name. That's the idea.
Swamiji, regarding this example that you gave about, you know, Sri Ramakrishna said that whom I call Kali is Brahman. And on that note, I mean, I was thinking that, you know, we in the path of knowledge, we often inquire into our own true nature, that who are we really? And we're not this body, we're not this mind, and we continue along that line of thought. At the same time, we can also ask, who is really God? And mm-hmm. we can ask that, is God really just this person, or you know, mm-hmm. what is he really, right? You can ask the same question, and you probably get to the same answer. That
absolutely.
Absolutely.
There is always the subject-object polarity. So I, as a seeker, and then there is the ideal that I am seeking. And I can keep on inquiring deeply into either of it. I can either start inquiring into the subjective pole, who is this I, or keep on inquiring into who is this object? Who is the real Ramakrishna? Is it the person who lived in that historical person, or a person who still dwells in my heart? So the person who dwells in my heart, what is the nature of that person? So either way, we deeply inquire into the reality of the ideal I am meditating on, or the one who is meditating, ultimately we will find we come at that same same truth. Since, and sometimes that's essentially how even in Vedanta, when we use the two terms Atman and Brahman are, I mean, why do we need? Are they two? No, it's reality is one. When I see that reality against the background of my present existence, like now, right now I have my body, mind and ego and all of that. Now I know behind this body, mind and ego, there is something which doesn't change, the unchanging me. So there is this reality of the unchanging me behind all the changing dimensions of my being. Now if I look at this entire universe, as much as I can see or think about, I see there are a lot of things changing behind the universe as well. Now, if there is some unchanging me behind all the changes that are occurring here, there is some unchanging one behind all the changes that are occurring externally. And what philosophies try to figure out is how the unchanging me here is related to the unchanging me there. That's essentially the different schools of philosophy. And so, if someone says, this unchanging me and that unchanging divine are always separate, that's dualism. The unchanging me here is a part of that big reality, it's qualified non-dualism, Vishishta Advaita. Or we say, well, the unchanging reality here and the unchanging reality behind the universe are one and the same, that's Advaita. So either way, we have to reach that unchanging here or there and discover the truth for ourselves. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, so we can stop here today. Or actually, we can do one more verse. That will be a good point to stop. Verse 10. Sarva bhutastham atmanam sarva bhutani chatmani sampashyan brahma paramam yati na anyena hetuna. Seeing the Atman in all beings and all beings in the Atman, and not by any other means, a person attains Brahman the highest. It's a beautiful, beautiful, very compact verse, which really tells us both the experience of the enlightened one and the practice of the unenlightened. So when a person becomes enlightened, such a person sees the Atman in everyone and everyone in the Atman. Sees one's own self in others and sees others in oneself. And you can see how easy it becomes for an enlightened being, therefore, to practice the golden rule. Swami Vivekananda says, love thy neighbor not simply as thyself, because your neighbor is yourself. So for an enlightened being, see, everyone is just myself. So of course you're going to be kind to everyone. Hating anyone means hating myself. Being cruel to someone means being cruel to myself. It's like this. If I bite my own tongue, I can't blame anyone. Well, it's my own tongue. I myself have bitten it. And so we are very careful. We might be ready to go and bite someone else. We don't want to bite ourselves because we get hurt. Now, if I see that everyone is myself, then I wouldn't want to hurt anyone. Now, that's something that happens naturally in the case of an enlightened being. Now, for us, this can become our practice. To recognize that every person I meet throughout the day, every person I meet in my dream, but forget about dream now, we don't have so much control over our dreams, but at least we can try every person we meet in our waking life to recognize that they are just a part of me. That's what Holy Mother meant when she said, the world is your own. No one is a stranger, my child, the world is your own. The more I able to see a reflection of myself in others, the less it'll be possible for me to hate anyone, to hurt anyone, to be unkind to anyone. You see, oftentimes, why is it that parents love their children? Well, all children are lovable. But somehow, even though all children may be lovable, one's own child is always a little bit more special. And the reason is, I'm able to see my reflection in my child. Now, if I'm able to see my reflection in everyone in the world, everyone becomes my child. So when the Holy Mother became a mother of all, because she saw everyone as their children. So we can see the whole, that's what the Holy Mother, it's a profound words for all their simplicity. Mother's last words are, we can meditate on it all through our life. What did she mean? The whole world is your own. No one is a stranger. That is exactly what the Upanishad is saying here. Seeing the Atman in all and seeing all in oneself. So that is the practice for the rest of us. That is an experience for the enlightened one. So we stop here today. And next time when we meet, we will begin with verse number 11.
Om Jananim Saradam Devim Ramakrishnam Jagat Gurum Padapadme Tayo Shritva Pranamami Muhur Muhu.
We bow down to Sri Ramakrishna and Holy Mother again and again. Our subject for next Sunday is meditation 101. This we'll have a more broader overview of what meditation practice is. Although many of you are already having a meditation practice of your own, it'll be good to kind of revisit and see some of the foundational principles of that practice. We'll do that on Sunday. Next Wednesday, it's very likely that we will have a guest Swami here. Swami Nirmalatmananda, who is the head of our center in Brazil, is coming. He will be speaking on some aspect of Vedanta next Wednesday. So all of you are welcome. Brazil didn't go far enough in the World Cup, so let's support him as much as we can. He's grieving, the whole of Brazil is grieving. So he will very likely be speaking next Wednesday, and then the Wednesday after that we will resume the study of Kaivalya Upanishad. And we will continue the meditation and arati as usual on Tuesday and Saturday. Let's conclude with a prayer now. May the Divine Being, who is the Father in Heaven of the Christians, Holy One of the Jewish faith, Allah of the Muslims, Buddha of the Buddhists, Tao of the Taoists, Ahura Mazda of the Zoroastrians, the Great Spirit of the Native Americans, and Brahman of the Hindus, lead us from the unreal to the real, from darkness to light, from death to immortality. May we be granted strength, freedom, and clear understanding. May we learn to see God in our own hearts and in everyone around us. May God bless us all and fill our hearts with gratitude, grace, and love. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Peace, peace, peace be unto God.